top 8 impactful spells of 2015. Now keep that in mind, it's not just cards or spells that were printed in 2015, it's the top 8 spells that had an effect on the metagame in 2015.
Right. All right. Before we get into our top 8 though, I think we do need to make... This is, I think, the first time we've ever done this.
We need to. Listen to Paul's words. We need to. Right.
This is the first time we've ever done a dishonorable mention.
I believe I should be the one to introduce it because I'm the one who played this at the Pro Tour.
All right. All right. Luis, what is our dishonorable mention for top 8 spells?
It's a Magmatic Insight, the one red, discard a land card to draw 2 cards. Played that in a mentor deck at a Pro Tour, and man, that card is not good. I think a big part of the reason you didn't play the deck is you had multiple games where you're just like, any spell and I get to cast Treasure Cruise, or any land and I get to cast Silumgar, and you just draw a Magmatic Insight. It is a card that if I believe it didn't get printed, I would have had a better finish that Pro Tour. Basically, Magmatic Insight cost me platinum in the World Championships.
Oh please!
He's saying it cost him platinum, like for this season. There's 3 Pro Tours to go.
First Pro Tour of the season. He's got plenty of time to do it. He's just relying on that failure.
Yeah, that's for Raptor. Raptor is the one who just loved this card.
When I miss platinum by 2 points, we can go back and I can say that.
That's the thing about Raptor. Raptor's like so boom bust with card evaluation. Yeah. He either hits that out of the park, you're like, okay, that card's just awful. I'm sorry.
You know? 1 mana draw 2. I mean, come on.
Yeah.
But I tested that mentor deck that, you know, most of the people on our team decided to play, and there were 2 games, like it was back to back, where I would have 5 lands in play, 2 Treasure Cruises in my hand, and 2 cards in my graveyard, and I also had 2 Magmatic Insights in my hand. And I'm just like, I can't cast any spell in my hand. This is absurd. And then I was just like, I was just immediately put off by the deck.
Well, and right you were. Yeah. Right you were.
I mean, I didn't choose a good deck myself, but probably better than Luis chose.
You don't need help from other people to make bad decisions, Paul. You make your own bad decisions.
Yeah. I know. Follow your heart.
You don't need Raptor for that.
That's right. I played green-white Megamorph. Incredibly medium.
All right. Top 8 spells, non-creature spells, I should say, creatures, but top 8 spells of impactful spells of 2015. Number 8, Collected Company. Yeah. Should have had Matt Nass Skype in for this one.
Yeah.
You almost said Matt Nash, who's also a Channel Fireball employee.
Matt Nash is a Channel Fireball employee, and he was here. He was here for a few weeks training.
Matt Nash?
So I was like, we have a Matt Nash.
Oh, do you?
We have Matt Nash and Matt Nass.
Wow.
So
nice.
There's endless Matt Nass jokes when Matt Nash is around.
Fair.
Also, for the record, Matt Nash, although they're not of the basketball variety, a chronic shorts wearer. He always wears shorts.
Matt Nash also wears shorts?
Matt Nash always wears shorts.
Oh my God, this is too good.
If it's cold enough, he'll wear long pants. But yeah, Matt Nash, he always wears like these khaki shorts.
Right,
so,
fair enough.
I don't know, something about Matt Nash, Nass.
Top 8 Matt Nass asterisks.
Yeah.
That'd be so good. Yeah. All right, sorry. Back to Collected Company.
Right. Yeah, I mean, Collected Company is a card that's seeing a lot of play now. It's, you know, seeing play in the combo deck. The 4-color rally combo deck, and it's a very, very important part of that. It's just value. It's 4 mana. I mean, you've seen this played, you know, in standard before. You had your Abzan Collected Company decks, but I mean, now you get to play in your combo decks, and you even see it being played in modern. I mean, this card's just been all over the place, just provides you a ton of value, and I haven't really been able to play this card too much. Like, the Collected Company type of decks, I either, like, played a few times and don't hit the creatures that I need, or you know, I was kind of afraid to play the Collected Company deck at the Pro Tour just because I wasn't, you know, I'm not really much of a combo player. But you know, I mean, I can see why this is a card that we have on the list.
It was definitely something I had. I didn't even rate it. I don't even want to say I had it underrated. It wasn't even on my radar as something that was going to be playable.
Yeah, I will admit this is one on my center view I did not give a very high ranking to. I'm just like, what are the odds that you get enough mana out of this? Turns out, when you have a lot of 3-drop creatures in your deck that really should cost like a little bit more than 3, or a lot of really good 2-mana creatures, you're paying 4 mana at instant speed for 5 or 6 mana worth of cards, sometimes even more. And that adds up. It turns out Collected Company is the real deal.
It is. All right, number 7, Ancient Stirrings.
Yeah. So, what are you stirring a pot, an invisible pot?
Yeah, and Luis is pretty ancient, so there we go.
Yeah, I'm definitely the second oldest person on the show right now.
That's true. That is very true.
Oh man, I'm the youngest. This is weird.
You're the youngest by far, aren't you, Paul?
You're the youngest, but that does not make you young. Just so
that was like a 2-for-1.
Oh god. It was a self burn. Ancient stirrings. It's funny that when someone mentioned banning ancient stirrings, I was like, wow, that actually makes a bit of sense. It's a key card in both Tron and Amulet. Turns out, again, 1 mana to look at 5 cards, very, very good.
Yeah. I mean, that's what's crazy about it, right? That it is 1 mana to look at 5 cards. All right, number 6. I don't know how much we're going to discuss Abzan in this Magic TV, but number 6 is Abzan Charm.
Yeah, yeah. I mean...
Paul, tell us how this card was used.
Yeah.
I don't want to talk about the... I don't want to talk about the Abzan deck, or else maybe I get in
trouble. Well, Paul, what are the modes of Abzan Charm?
It's a card that's played.
No, what are the modes? What are the modes? Simple breakdown.
Right, pay 2 life.
Okay.
Draw 2 cards.
Okay.
Lose 2 life. Draw 2 cards.
Sure.
Put 2+1/+1 counters. Exile target creature power 3 or more. That's my contribution.
That kind of utility. It's a Swiss Army knife. Like all commands, modal spells by their definition, commands in particular, they're Swiss Army knives. So what do you need to do? Do you need to draw a card? Do you need to get rid of the threat? Do you need to buff up something on your side? It answered all of those problems, and it was uniquely situated in Abzan as a deck, which we may or may not get into in a future topic.
Yeah, I mean, the card was just absolutely absurd. It's just automatic 4+ in all the decks.
Sure.
It's a card that's... Like, all of its modes were actually just very, very powerful. Mm-hmm. I guess the distribute 2 counters didn't happen often.
The threat of that mode was good. But
yeah, exactly.
It cast very often.
Sometimes you could just attack your Courser of Kruphix into your opponent's Courser of Kruphix just to threaten Abzan Charm.
Right.
You know, mm-hmm. Not only that, it's a source of card advantage and also was a removal spell. I mean, this was one of the most important cards in that Abzan deck. I mean, Abzan was just absurd because all of the cards were just so powerful just individually.
Well, and none of them were dead. The strong part about Abzan Charm is even against a creatureless deck, you draw 2 cards. Mm-hmm. And against decks with creatures, obviously, it's a removal spell.
Right.
All of Abzan's cards are super flexible. Thoughtseize is great against basically everyone but Mono Red. So Abzan just got to cheat by having these great answers that weren't dead against other decks.
Luis, we have a section later on Top 8 Decks of 2015.
Well, Abzan Charm was really the flag bearer of that.
It was. Like I said, we may or may not get into it later, but the flexibility of charms in general and Abzan Charm specifically, particularly when it can straddle I'm playing in a creature-based matchup, so I have an answer there, or I'm not. I'm playing in a control-based matchup, and I have the answer there, which is more cards. So the resource, being able to play both sides like that and adapt to your opponent's deck is the most important part of the charm itself. All right. Coming in at number 5, because we love modal spells on this list.
Right.
Commands. We just grouped them all together. The commands.
Yeah. When we were going over the top 8 spells, there were just so many great spells.
Well, mm-hmm. It's all the commands minus Silumgars.
Minus Silumgars.
Okay. Silumgars is out. Sorry.
That's seen some limited play, but yeah, we grouped all the commands so we can fill up the list with some other sweet spells. But I mean, we're talking Dromoka's command, Colligan's command, Ojitai's command. They're all just. Absolutely insane.
Yeah.
And I mean, that's why we have it on the list. What's your favorite command, Luis?
The one I enjoy casting the most, I believe, is Colligan's command.
Yeah,
just because that's the one that has, in Modern specifically, the most modes that are relevant. It's one of those Magic the Puzzling cards where at the start of any given turn where you have a Colligan's command, you have a lot of really cool options. Just between the fact that lots of artifacts get played in Modern, mm-hmm. you get to make them discard a card, kill one of their creatures, get something back. It has a nice synergy with Snapcaster. But Otarka's command is also fairly fun. Otarka's command is distinctly less fun because it always goes in the stack targeting me, and
I always lose to it. That's probably the command you lose to most often.
Yeah.
Oh yeah.
By a wide margin.
It raises the hype level for the rest of us.
I can never beat Otarka's command decks, and I can never lose to Ojitai's command mirrors. So.
Oh wow!
It's a blessing and a curse, apparently.
Sick brags.
Yeah. I love Colligan's command too. That'd be my favorite. What's your favorite, Paul?
Ojitai's command.
Ojitai. Yeah. You know what?
Plus, I heard his Dromoka's command because he played that deck at the Pro Tour and it was his favorite deck.
Oh my god. Oh my god.
I should have known Ojitai's command. It is definitely the most Paul card.
He loves blue white. He loves keeping his mana untapped. He does both those things pretty well.
Yeah.
So. Yeah, well, I mean, that card fits very well.
Fits very well. Strategy. Number 4 Hero's Downfall, and this was a card that I feel like we were talking about exiting Standard when it was on its way out and filling the void for Hero's Downfall. I mean, such a great card. Being able to either take out the most relevant creature or Planeswalker was amazing. That flexibility was awesome. Right. Kind of. I always feel bad for the hero. It's like getting stepped on. What a horrible way to go, getting crushed.
Oh, the picture?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Oh,
that is pretty brutal.
It's a brutal, brutal picture. But yes, number four is Hero's Downfall. How many downfalls did you guys cast in 2015?
I didn't cast a ton.
Yeah.
I tended not to play. I mean, I played some in like the blue-black control decks, but I don't even remember what decks I was playing, but I was not playing tons of Hero's Downfalls. I was not, you know, Owen was the one who played a lot more Hero's
Definitely.
Downfalls.
Definitely.
Yeah. I played like...
The thing about Hero's Downfall is it gave the odds-on deck tools that can kill creatures or planeswalkers. So it had a lot of these removal spells that weren't dead. It's kind of like Odds-On Charm and Thoughtseize, where it was just able to handle all these...
just name more cards, Luis, and more decks. It's not like we're doing top 8 decks next, but it's okay. It's okay, Luis.
Okay, Luis.
Yeah, so I have also cast my fair share of Heroes Downfalls. I've played various mid-range strategies and control decks, and obviously this is just a fantastic card in both of those decks. The fact that it's instant speed just makes it so much better than what we have access to now, which is Ruinous Path. You see,
yeah, Ruinous Path looked awesome, but like you said,
it's just no Heroes Downfall.
But it just doesn't go into Abzan and all these other decks.
Ruinous Path was a bit of a bust. We tested it a lot before the Pro Tour. We never ended up playing it, and basically no one ended up playing it in any of their decks.
Right.
Like,
no.
And it's a one of in some decks or whatever?
It's definitely a bust. I think we all thought, okay, this is it. Get hyped. This is the new Hero's Downfall. I think I certainly was very high on the card. And turns out not the case.
Well, because it just reads exactly the same as Hero's Downfall.
Yeah, you think...
Turns out you turn that instant into sorcery. You know, it's a big
loses
deal.
Loses quite a step, definitely.
Well, yeah, because you played in the control decks. You always want to leave your mana up. Mm-hmm.
It literally loses a step if you look at the art.
Oh, wow. That wasn't bad.
Luis Scott Vargas, everybody. That's why
you set him up for that one.
Yeah. No, I did.
Actually,
not intentionally. Not intentionally. All right.
I actually have to give Luis an A for that one.
Oh.
That was pretty good.
Don't worry, I already gave myself. Paul.
He gave himself an A+ in the chat.
Oh, my God.
Oh, my God.
Paul.
This is unreal.
If you want to give Luis an A, you do that privately,
okay,
alone,
sorry.
When Luis is not around.
God.
Okay, you see what happens here?
He gave himself an A. You cannot give yourself an A.
Oh, my gosh. Oh, all right. Number three, in an attempt to dig our way out of this, Thoughtseize.
Well, Luis already talked about this card, so tell us, what do you think about Thoughtseize?
What decks did Thoughtseize see play in? I don't know, Luis. Where did we see Thoughtseize?
You know, I'm glad this card is you know, at this point has already left and we don't have to play with it in Standard anymore.
It's true.
It was so frustrating to just play against Obzon and just have them Thoughtseize just whatever card was relevant. And yeah, the card saw play in Esper Dragons too. You saw play in Mardu. It was just a great card. Obviously, it sees a ton of play. I think that the format is better off without it running around, but it did, you know, we saw Obzon fall from number one by far to just one of the decent decks in the format once Thoughtseize left. Turns out Thoughtseize, much like the instant speed on Hero's Downfall, Thoughtseize is just one of the key parts about Obzon.
Well, the card's amazing. I mean, it's so ridiculously efficient. One mana, sure, two life, whatever. I get to take the best thing out of your hand, and I get to do it on turn one. Your turn zero, if I won the dice roll, I mean, the card's busted. We know that. And with any of these spells, there's so many great spells at any given time in Magic. It is about what else is around it. But yeah, Thoughtseize, an unbelievable card. And as Luis already pointed out, it's one of those cards that its absence was so felt. You knew immediately that Thoughtseize was gone, right?
Just like take a look just at all the tools that like kind of that Abzan deck actually had, right? We have all these cards on the list, and all these cards are no longer legal, and it still won the Pro Tour.
Mm-hmm.
You know, that's just insane to me.
Paul, we're going to talk about decks later, so I'm not sure.
Okay, so Thoughtseize was great because, you know, or not great, but I mean, it was so bad to play against because you would keep your opening hand, and when you keep your opening hand, you're like formulating a game plan. You're like, all right, I'm going to do this, I'm going to do that, and then your opponent just goes swamp Thoughtseize. Just kind of ruins all of that. You know, everything that you're trying to do, it just completely.
Well, that's why you have to play your own Thoughtseize, because you put your opponent on that plan of, do I need to take their Thoughtseize to stay on target?
That was a very common play.
Oh,
you Thoughtseize their Thoughtseize.
Right, you had to, because you were like, wait, If I don't take their Thoughtseize, they're going to screw up what I have coming up next, right?
Yeah. Well, what the net effect of that was is you couldn't play a deck where your cards relied on other cards, or at least it was much riskier to do so. So instead of synergy decks, we saw a lot of good stuff decks in 2015. Siege Runner doesn't care too much if another Siege Runner or a Courser gets Thoughtseized, but if you're playing a deck, like a combo deck of some kind, and you get Thoughtseize, that hurts you a lot more.
Oh, yeah.
So that's why we saw less interesting decks. Thoughtseize, I think, pushes you towards these just piles of cards instead of actual decks.
Mm-hmm. And that's why it was one of the best cards, impactful cards of 2015. Okay, number two. Number one, number two. Is this another one where there's... Does everybody know what number
two... Saying one will give up... Saying number two will give up number
That's how it always is with these, Luis. So, all right, take a second now in the chat. Try to determine what's number two, what's number one, where are we going out with this list. If you're watching this on channelfireball.com, take a second, hit pause. We're still going to be here. Put your guess for number one and number two, and you got to say which is one and which is two, obviously, if you've already narrowed it down to those two, in the Facebook comments. We do check those out. So are we there? Do we know what it is?
I mean, we know what it is. We've made the list.
Oh, well, yeah, I mean, we know. You know, I will say this. This is a last minute change. The list used to be a little bit different. So, yeah. All right. I think we're good. Number two, Treasure Cruise.
Yeah, I mean,
I actually disagreed with this ordering. I like Cruise at number one, but Cruise is a fine number two, and I think this is similar to the Jace Siege Rhino ordering, where, yeah, we say number two, number one, because that's how the list goes, but it's really, they're both kind of tied for first.
Yeah.
And, yeah, you can say Treasure Cruise, certainly. Treasure Cruise has seen less play in Standard than, let's say, another card, very similar to it.
Yeah.
But is way more busted in the older formats. And either way, it turns out in a format with cantrips and fetch lands, these cards are just too good.
Yeah, they're insane. They're insane.
Got banned in Modern. I mean, number one, we're just going to talk about them both once, actually. Yeah. Dig Through Time, of course, being number one. They both got banned in Modern. When Dig and Cruise were legal, you should not have been playing a deck that did not have one of those cards in it. Probably Treasure Cruise, probably Blue-Red. And they both got banned in Legacy, eventually. And they both got restricted in Vintage, though. In all these cases, Cruise went, then Dig went.
Yeah, right.
Which I think indicates to me that Dig should be number two instead of number one, but either way.
Well, but, I mean, if you're looking at... If you're looking in the scope of just, like, Standard as well, Standard is the most popular format.
Yeah, yeah. Yes.
And in Standard, you saw far less Treasure Cruise, because obviously in Standard, you don't have access to all those, you know, cheap cantrips that allow you to fill up your graveyard as quickly. Mm-hmm. You know, Dig Through Time saw a lot more play. But you know what? Actually, you know, this is so high up on our list. Number two, you know what Treasure Cruise combos pretty well with? Our Dishonorable Mention.
That's the theory, at least.
That's the theory.
That's how you draw it up.
For record's sake, number one, of course, Dig Through Time. And, you know, we split them up, which was tough. They're very similar cards. And originally, just to give you a little inside baseball here, we just had at the number one slot the Delve cards. Because Become Immense is another card with Delve that had a huge impact, I think, in 2015. But yeah, Treasure Cruise and Dig, 1A, 1B, really depends on what format you're talking about, right? Like, they play different roles in different formats. Obviously, and it's funny because this was a decision, you know, splitting up the 1 and 2 and Dig in 1 and Treasure Cruise in 2 that Channel Fireball editor-in-chief Andy Cooperfaust put out there. But it really kind of feels like Raptor did it, didn't it? Because Raptor was Mr. Dig from day one.
That is true.
Even
in the Delver decks.
Oh, yeah. Just dig,
get you
all
two
the way.
Bolts.
Yeah, Dig is so much better.
Right. Yeah, obviously, Luis would advocate for Treasure Cruise because he's the vintage player.
Yeah, Ancestral,
here.
Right?
Yeah.
You know, people are saying that Cruise is only legal for 19 days in this year, which is true, but it did a lot those 19 days. And I think part of the bias is that I played so much Vintage this year, and Treasure Cruise and Dig were so impactful in Vintage that throughout this course of the year, which I understand is not most people's experience, but
right.
If you look at the amount of Magic I played that was with Vintage, it was actually pretty high.
Yeah. Well, there you have it, our top eight spells. To the degree you disagree, to the degree you agree, let us know. You can always tweet at us, or you can put it in the Facebook comments. Tweeting's actually a good way to do it, because I think I...
Just don't tweet at me. The other two are fine.
So that's right, at LSV... at Helf, of course, at the guy on the left, any of those things will get to us eventually. Wow, we're halfway through.
Yeah.
Two more top eights. I feel like the next top eight is a top eight you two have been wanting to talk about all night.